Marko Mäkelä, lead developer InnoDB at MariaDB Corporation. Today I will cover some relook format changes that have been motivated by performance improvements. You are probably aware of the concept of ACID transactions, atomic, consistent, isolated and durable. In MariaDB, we do this by a combination of locking and logging. At the SQL layer, we have metadata logs, which are logs on database or table names. Every access to tables is covered by those logs. Inside InnoDB, we have table logs and index record logs and page latches. And non-locking reads inside InnoDB are not acquiring any table logs or index record logs, only page latches. And one important thing is that the locking will allow us to roll back any changes. So for example, if something is deleted, we will not immediately delete the data. We will write a log record that we are going to delete it. And after the transaction has been committed, only after that, and only if no older transaction may need to see the old data, only after that we are allowed to delete that data. It's called the purge of history in InnoDB. And similar for drop index or drop table, we are not allowed to delete the files or free any pages before the dropping has been committed. Any important state changes must be durably written to the redo log first. A user transaction typically consists of several mini transactions, and if we want the commit of that user transaction to be durable, then we will have to write all the redo log until the last mini transaction of the transaction which marks the undo log header to be in committed state. In InnoDB, we have two layers, mini transactions which cover atomic changes to multiple pages, and then we have the transaction layer which records changes to index pages into undo log pages. So before a transaction can modify an index record, it must first write an undo log record for that change. That I'm going to insert this record, or I'm going to delete mark this record, or I'm going to update this record in this way. In case the database recovers with an incomplete transaction, it will roll back that transaction. And even if some redo log was written for that operation, we will be able to restore the old contents of the table. We implement write-ahead logging both for the undo log, that the undo log must be written first, and then we write the changes to the index pages, and for the redo log. So we are not allowed to write any pages, undo or index pages, before we have written the corresponding log record to the redo log. On a redo log checkpoint, we will make a We will truncate the start of the redo log logically. So recovery will start from the checkpoint LSN until to the end of the log record that is detected when passing the log. And the log checkpoint will ensure that all changes that are older than the new checkpoint LSN have been written to the data files. And then we update the checkpoint LSN to point to the new start of the redo log. This will allow recovery to save time because it has less redo log to process. Here is a diagram from my previous FOSDEM talk from last year that shows how the mini transactions and the buffer pool and the redo log and the data files work. So in blue color, we have some log that the mini transaction is going to, things that the mini transaction is going to change. And some blue pages in the buffer pool which mini transaction is going to change. At the end of the mini transaction, we are going to commit the mini transaction. There is no rollback for mini transactions, it is only commit. The commit will acquire a mutex so that we can copy the local log records to the global log system buffer. And at that point, we obtain the start and end LSN of that mini transaction. If some page was previously clean in the buffer pool, and we are the first ones to make it dirty, we will update the oldest modification LSN of the block descriptor. And for any modified block, we will update the fill page LSN in the page header to the end LSN of the mini transaction. So once we have released the log system mutex, we will update the buffer page header and the descriptor. And after that, we are allowed to release the page latches so that other threads can access these pages again. At some later point, the log buffer will be durably written to the circular read log file. And after those changes have been written to the read log, then the dirty pages from the buffer pool flush list may be written to the data files. How does crash recovery work? How do we recover changes that have been made since the latest checkpoint LSN? Well, we have a circular read log, and we will map the checkpoint LSN to some location in that read log. And the checkpoints will have to be frequent enough so that this circular read log file will not overwrite itself. The file size is fixed at file creation, and when we write the log, we wrap around from the end of the file to the start of the record area. So we must perform frequent enough checkpoints, and if you want the database to perform fast, then you should ensure that the log file size is at least the size of the buffer pool size, maybe much bigger. In MariaDB Server 10.5, we improved the memory efficiency of the recovery, so it should be much less probable to run out of memory during recovery, even if the read log to be recovered is much bigger than the buffer pool size. A simplified view of the log file is like this. This is actually the exact view with the upcoming MariaDB 10.8 version. We have a half a kilobyte header block that identifies the log format so that we can prevent a downgrade to an earlier version. And it also stores a field first LSN, which is the log sequence number corresponding to the start of the record payload area, this start offset. Then we have two blocks for storing checkpoint information. In those checkpoint blocks, we store the checkpoint LSN, which is the start of the read log. And then we store an additional LSN, which points to the end of the log when the checkpoint was created. We will find some file name information there. And these two checkpoint blocks are being written in an alternating fashion, so that if the server is killed during while the checkpoint block was being written, then we will recover the previous checkpoint from the other block. For the log records, we will have all the data area from this start offset to the end of the log file. And the byte offset of a log sequence number is simply obtained by subtracting the first LSN from the LSN and taking the modulus with the log capacity and adding the start offset. With previous formats, when we had some framing log block headers and footers, it was not this simple, and we also had multiple log files in earlier versions. But now with a single log file, it is this simple. A simplified view of recovery is that we start from the checkpoint LSN after we have determined the latest checkpoint LSN, and then we jump to this special int lsn to find some possibly find some file modifier records which are for data files that were modified since the previous checkpoint, and then we'll find a file checkpoint record that must point to that checkpoint lsn of our checkpoint block. Once we have found that, we know that the read block is not inconsistent, we can continue with the recovery from the checkpoint lsn. We will parse the records until we reach some inconsistency, which must be the end of the circular log. So after the last complete mini transaction, we will typically find a check some mismatch, or we will find some abrupt end of a log record, or we will find a sequence number mismatch. When we are processing the records, we will construct a mapping from numeric table space identifiers to file names. So this avoids reading all the data files to determine the mapping from table space IDs to file names. Because we store the file names in the read log, we will only have to open those files that have been mentioned by the read log. Other files which have not been changed, we don't have to open or access. If you have millions of files and in the read log you only have maybe tens or thousands of files, then recovery will avoid the costly operation of opening all your million data files. While we are processing those records, we will also construct a hash table that whose key is the table space identifier and the page number, and the value is the sequence of records for that page. So all those records will have to be applied to the page, and then we will have the correct state of the page. The memory management is rather interesting. We have to allocate memory for buffer pool pages that we are recovering. Typically, we would read pages from the data files, but there is a special optimization or we could also say resiliency or robustness feature in MariaDB 10.2 and later. If we find that the page was entirely initialized via the read log records, if we have an initialization record for that page, then we can discard all previous buffered record for that page, and we don't have to read the page. We just apply the records from the initialization to the last record that we have for the page. So we only have to write the page, not read it at all. But we have to allocate the page in the buffer pool for writing it. In MariaDB 10.5, there is an additional optimization that if the page was freed since the checkpoint, then we can simply discard all the log records until this free page record, and we don't have to write anything to the data file. In the buffer pool, we also have this hash table of log records for each page number and table space ID. So we may run out of space if we are filling the whole buffer pool with the. We must not fill the whole buffer pool with the hash table, because we also need space for the page images. So we may have to execute multiple apply batches. And at the end of each batch, we will evict and write out and evict all the pages from the buffer pool. Only during the final batch, we can keep dirty pages in the buffer pool. We can write them out at our leisure, but we have to write them out before the next checkpoint. And theoretically, we could allow concurrent access to the database. Currently, it's not implemented, but there is a task MDEV14481 for implementing log record apply in the background. Now we are coming to the format changes. How was the format changed for improved performance or simpler processing? Well, in MariaDB 10.5, we got the new physical easy to parse log record format. Before that, from the very first InnoDB version, there was a strange format that is a kind of a mixture of logical and physical logging. And those log records didn't have any explicit length stored anywhere. So to parse the log records, we would have to apply the log to in a dummy fashion. We would pass a null page pointer to the apply function. The apply function would be identified by the read log record type. Also, we had the read log records stored in half a kilobyte blocks with some header and footer bytes. So it was tricky to read the read log file because the bytes of read log records were not contiguous. They could be interrupted by this footer and header bytes. In the upcoming MariaDB 10.8 change, we are removing this block structure. And at the end of each mini transaction, we are storing a sequence bit and a checksum. In this way, we can process the records directly from the redo log record buffer. We don't have this recovery buffer anymore. We can have a larger buffer that we are recovering from. And if the system is configured so, we can memory map the entire log file to this log system buffer. So we don't have to execute any system calls for reading the log. We can just read from the log system buffer. The format change in MariaDB 10.5 was that each log record will start with a type and length byte. 4 bits of type and 4 bits of length. If the record length is between 1 and 15 bytes, then the entire length will be encoded in that first byte. If this first byte is 0, then it's the end of the minute transaction, or it is a padding byte that we use for filling a complete half a kilobyte block. If the length bits are 0, then we know that this log record will be longer than 16 bytes, and there will be additional bytes for encoding the remaining length, again in a variable length fashion. So if the additional length is less than 128 bytes, we will encode it in 1 byte. After this type and length, we will encode the table space identifier and the page number. Each of them will use 1 to 5 bytes. And these fields can be omitted if a special same page bit was set in the type field, but that's never set for the first record of a mini transaction. Any remaining bytes of the record, their format depends, or their interpretation depends on the log type. But when we are parsing the log records and buffering them in the hash table, we don't need to know the format of the remaining bytes. We will just store this entire record for that page, and that's it during recovery, during the parsing. When we apply the record, then we will have to know how to interpret those remaining bytes. And what if this same page bit is set in the very first record of the mini transaction? Well, in that case, we know that this mini transaction is actually covering file level changes. It's not for page level read log. So we will have file names or the special file checkpoint record in that mini transaction. In the upcoming MariaDB 10.8 change, we are abandoning this half a kilobyte log block format. So we are not using the null bytes for padding anymore, and we must store a checkpoint directly after the mini transaction because we don't have the block structure where the block would have a checksum. So we are changing the format a bit. The end of the mini transaction will be signaled by a byte that is 1 or a 0. This is possible because the init page record whose type bits would be 0, that record length will always be at least 3 bytes. So the length bits would be at least 2 and at most 10. If the read log is encrypted, then we would store an additional 8 byte nonce after this end byte. And after that, we will store a 4-byte checksum of the mini transaction, except this end byte. The end byte, it depends on the LSN that we are writing the record to. It is a sequence bit. It is counting the times the circular read lock has wrapped around from the end to the start offset modulo 2. For padding, if we wanted to avoid overwriting the last lock block, we could write dummy mini transactions to pad the block to the full length so that the next write would be to the next block. The parser support for this is implemented, but we are not emitting these padding records right now. Here's an example how a log record would look like. First, we have a write record 3-5. 3 means write, and 5 means that there are 5 more bytes to follow. And we have the table space ID 0 and page number 8. After that, we have an offset that is encoded in 2 bytes, and we have 1 byte to write to that offset of that page. Next record is also write, but it has the same page bit set. The most significant bit is set, and we have 9 bytes to follow that byte. So the offset that is following the type byte is relative to the previous offset where the previous write left off, and the remaining bytes will be bytes to write at that offset. Then we have the end of the mini transaction and the value of the sequence bit. And finally, we have the checksum of the mini transaction excluding the end byte. For encryption, we never encrypt the file names, logbit sequence numbers, table space IDs or page numbers. They were always available in the encrypted data files anyway, so we are not leaking any information there. This means that decryption is only needed when we apply the log, not for backup. And we don't need to hold any mutex when we are encrypting or calculating checksums, because the encryption doesn't depend on the LSN. The payload will be encrypted using an initialization vector of the table space ID, page number, and the 8-byte nonce that we will write before the checksum. So in the previous slide, all the non-bold bytes could be encrypted if the log were encrypted. We also made some changes to the file system interface. On Linux and Windows, we can now detect the physical block size and use it. So if you have a 4 kilobyte block size on your hard disk or SSD, we will use that size when writing the redo log. And on Linux, we can now allow ODirect on the log file. On Windows, we previously did it if the block size was 0.5 kilobyte. When the server is built with persistent memory support, we can use memory mapped I/O to make the log system buffer point directly to the persistent memory. And on Linux, we can use fake PMEM when the log is under dev shm. That gains us a bit faster regression test runs and more convenient debugging with the RR debugger, because the entire log will be available in the memory and you can conveniently set watch points on that memory. And also as a user, you can try to point the read log to dev shm to get an estimate how much performance you would get if you installed a PMEM device to buffer your read log. Okay, thank you. That was all I wanted to say in my presentation. I'm very happy to answer any questions that you have. Thank you for your attention.